anybody who's a friend of Vladimir Putin must disregard the fact that Vladimir Putin is a murderer, a thug, a KGB agent, whose airplanes, as we speak, have been targeting with precision weapons hospitals in Aleppo, who have committed atrocities throughout the region, and has destabilized Ukraine, has invaded Ukraine, trying to destabilize Baltic countries, and the list goes on and on.
As you can see there, no friend of Vladimir Putin and John McCain. So hawks like Senator McCain and his friend Lindsey Graham say they have a confirmation test for Mr. Tillerson.
I want to hear from him if he believes the Russians tried to interfere in our election, they're trying to destabilize democracies. And if somebody wants to be Secretary of State and they hear the briefings that I've heard and they don't believe the Russians were involved in our election, interfering in our elections, then I really question their judgment. And if they don't believe sanctions are appropriate given what Putin's been doing all over the world, including our backyard, then I don't think they have the judgment to be Secretary of State, because if you don't go after Russia, you're inviting the other bad actors on the planet to come after you.
So Mr. Tillerson's going to have some rough sledding. Is it possible, number one, that Donald Trump's choice to be Secretary of State will be rejected by a Republican Senate? Is it possible? And even more so, I suspect the answer to that is no in the end, because Mr. Tillerson is a very impressive person by all those who know him. But this is a proxy to get the answers we were just trying to get in the last segment, right? Does Donald Trump, is he ready to concede Russia hacked us? Is he ready to concede Putin is not a cuddly teddy bear?
Well, it would certainly be helpful to Rex Tillerson's odds if Donald Trump said something even remotely critical or skeptical of Russia between now and Tillerson's confirmation hearings. Like you said, I think it's unlikely that he actually gets rejected by the Senate, in part because Senator McConnell has already thrown his support behind Tillerson. But also, as you said, people who know him say that he's very smart, he's very direct, he's very captivating, that when he gets one-on-one with these senators in meetings and even when he gets in hearings, he'll be able to win them over. But I do think as part of that, obviously he's going to be forced to answer a lot of uncomfortable questions about whether he thinks Russia meddled in the election. It's helpful to not get further in front of the principal on that. That's why it'd be helpful for Donald Trump to say something. But I think he's also going to need to come into these meetings and say, look, I had a good relationship with Putin when I was representing the interests of my shareholders, but now that I'm representing the interests of Americans, that relationship needs to change. But he's going to have to be convincing for people like Senator McCain, for people like Senator Graham.
Yeah, and those two senators are looking for some ground to fight on here when it comes to Russia. They, it's important to note, are going the weekend after Christmas. The two of them are going on what I call a screw you Vladimir tour. It's not officially called that. The Kodal.
That's maybe a formal name for it.
But seriously, they're going to the Baltic states, they're going to Georgia, and they're going to the Ukraine. And the message there is pretty straightforward. It is to, you know, make clear to Putin that not everybody back in Washington has a sort of him, but also to offer some reassurances to our allies, you know, in those countries that America is still on their side, or at least elements of the American government are still on their side. And so those two senators are looking for ground here. Now, I don't know if they can ultimately try to stop Tillerson's nomination, but they are going to make this confirmation process entirely about Russia if they have anything to say about it.
Right, but it's interesting, the choice, because it's another, and we'll get to some of the others in just a moment, but it's one of these choices that Trump has made that to a degree unnerves the Washington establishment. And as you heard, Senator McCain and Senator Graham and Marco Rubio's in the same camp with them, saying, wait a minute, a friend of Vladimir Putin is not the right person to be Secretary of State. That's what Washington says, Donald Trump says, as he did during the campaign. You're wrong.
Rex is friendly with many of the leaders in the world that we don't get along with. And some people don't like that. They don't want him to be friendly. That's why I'm doing the deal with Rex, because I like what this is all about.
You can make from, think of it as Trump thinks of things, as a negotiation.
Oh, sure.
If you read the art of the deal, that you, if you want to send a guy in to, sometimes, if the idea is to deliver a tough message to Putin, better to have it delivered by somebody he knows and respects and likes, right, than somebody who he thinks is a clown.
You know, the interesting thing is, I mean, if you put this in kind of the context of political campaigns, so far, Rex Tillerson has been defined by everybody but Rex Tillerson.
Right.
And I think everybody has to keep an open mind. I think Jonathan's right that Senators McCain and Graham will use these hearings. And we've seen Senator McCain over the years use hearings effectively to drive a series of questions and a series of answers that he's looking for, and to create a moment and to create discomfort for somebody who's on the opposite side of the table. But I don't think we know at all at this point how Mr. Tillerson is going to approach this. Sarah's right. It would be helpful if Donald Trump said something acknowledging in some even gentle way that he believes that the Russians were involved.
We've got a lot
more to hear from Mr. Tillerson.
And one of the early tests of how good the Republican president, who remember was not the choice of many establishment Republicans, how much is Israel, how good or good, bad, or in the middle his relationship will be. Another choice that has unnerved a lot of the Washington establishment and unnerved a lot of people in the Middle East as well is David Friedman, the president's choice to be ambassador to Israel. He's a bankruptcy lawyer. He's known Trump for years. He's a critic of the two-state solution, saying he doesn't see it as viable, at least right now, to have a separate Palestinian state. He wants to move the embassy ASAP from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, which is against years of U.S. policy, which says the fate of Jerusalem will be decided in negotiations between the parties. He has expanded settlements in the West Bank. What is Donald Trump trying to say here?
Well, he's sending someone over to Israel as his ambassador, if he's confirmed, who marks a shift in U.S. policy on a lot of these hot-button issues. There's been some reporting out of Israel about how he is even to the right of Bibi Netanyahu, which creates a fascinating political dynamic in Israeli politics. You know, Trump has talked about Middle East peace as the greatest deal. If he could do one deal as president, that's the one he wants to do. Should we look at this as part of his negotiations, as part of his strategy, sending a hardliner over as ambassador so that perhaps he can send an envoy who's able to work both sides? Possibly. Or do we look at this and look at Friedman's positions on settlements, on a two-state solution, and think that that is going to be Donald Trump's policy? If that is going to be his policy, it makes an eventual peace deal much less likely.
Disappointment really captures why it's folly to try to make heads or tails of the Trump strategy going into his presidency. This is somebody who, as Julie said, talked about, you know, trying to make the ultimate deal, Mideast peace, for months. Somebody who actually angered some pro-Israel groups because he was so, it seemed like, to deal over there. And then, you know, he actually becomes president, and the folks around him are much more hawkish when it comes to the Middle East. And he's obviously very heavily influenced by his son-in-law, Jared Kushner, on Middle Eastern issues. And the next thing you know, he's nominated to be ambassador to Israel is an uber hawk on Mideast peace. So, you know, it's a long ways away from Trump being at the RJC conference and being asked about moving the capital or the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem and saying, I'm not sure yet about that. And being booed, by the way, being booed. So the bottom line is we just don't know what he's going to do, because a lot of it depends upon who's in his ear, what his motivation is at that moment.
Right. And so one other quick point before we go here is that we have one president at a time. That's usually the operating policy. There was an incident in the last several days over the weekend in which the Chinese seized an American drone, underwater drone, in the South China Sea. And they negotiated to get it back. But Donald Trump, first he tweeted how it was a misspelling in one of them, rips it out of the water and takes it in an unprecedented act in the repeat when it was redone. It was done. You can find the spelling error online if you want. But then last night he tweets, we should tell China we don't want the drone they stole back. Let them keep it. Shaking things up in one of the most complicated and delicate relationships in the world, which he has shown no hesitancy to sort of, you know, get the Chinese thinking, what's next?
Well, and the Chinese will probably show no hesitancy in pushing back. I mean, they are a country that has pretty easy ways to be provocative, and they've been sending messages. If you read some of the state publications in China, they are sending messages that they're not going to go easy on this.
But even President Obama did seem to say, you know what, maybe we do need to rethink this a little bit, but just his advice was to try to do it more delicately. If you shake it up, shake it up. Maybe it needs to be done, but be a little bit more gentle.
Trump's really not great on gentle and delicate and sort of like sending subtle messages. He doesn't really do that. But the thing that you should realize is his view and his top advisor's view is China's the main event.
If they're going to shake up a relationship and, you know, break some glass, it's going to be with China. And that is, you know, when we saw Mitt Romney running, he said Russia's our number one geopolitical foe. Donald Trump really sees that as China through the lens of what he wants to get done, through the lens of creating jobs, through the lens of creating the American worker. So to him, no relationship is more strategic than the one with China, and I don't think that he's particularly worried about angering them. 30.